Longevity gives you something. Martin knew my work, not only from film, but also from the theater, which is a really important part of my life and his. So that was a plus. But when I first read it, I loved it. I thought Mildred was amazing. I was very flattered. But then I said, no, I'm sorry, I'm too old. Because at the time he gave it to me, I was 58. I'm 60 now, so a couple years ago. And I'm really interested in playing my age. I like being my age. And I kind of have a political thing about it. So I'm also from a working class background. And I was concerned that women from this socioeconomic strata did not wait till they were 38 to have their first child. And so we went back and forth, and we debated that for quite a while. And then finally my husband said, just shut up and do it. We started with a piece of literary material. Martin writes a script that stands on its own. It's not a blueprint for a film. It's an actual literary document, like a play, like a novel, like a short story, so that when a company can go back to something like that, I call it the Bible, if even the grips and the electrics can look at that as the platform for the story, then three quarters of the work's done. But I think really importantly, I think we all knew that it was at its fundamental core, a story about grief and trauma. And lots of things come out of that experience. And sometimes it's funny. Part of what made us an automatic ensemble, not just the fact that Martin had written the parts for us and also had worked with many of us, is that we all do come out of the theater. Woody has done theater. The majority of the actors have. So we,
John Hawks,
everybody. So that's our foundation, and it's the best foundation for any kind of acting work. And then the fact that Martin has been in rehearsal rooms, so even though his inexperience as a filmmaker, he's only done three films, but he's been in the room watching characters develop through an actor's process. So that's just a given. We don't have to talk about that much. We just all kind of, we hit the ground running at the same speed. Yeah. It's found that it's very dangerous to, at least in my experience, to let actors improvise, because we work from our subconscious. It's subtext. So if you let two actors write a scene together, it's all about subtext. It has no dramatic arc, has no beginning, middle, and end. Leave it to the experts. Unless you happen to be a good writer, but don't improvise unless asked to. I have the great luxury of passing on opportunities because I have a life in the theater. That's the ongoing work and films. Then I have the luxury of choosing films because my work comes from the theater, my foundation of my work. But so recently it was interesting because I was offered two roles, both 60-year-old women. Both had recently lost their husbands. One was grief-stricken over losing her husband, and the other was quite happy about it. I don't really want to do either of them, but if I chose one, it would be the one that was happy about it. Just for fun, right? So I think that what's great about Mildred is that it is not, she does stand out of, she stands out of time in our culture because she's not based on ageism. It's not about her trying not to be her age or pretending to be or having to carry the mantle of a female of a certain age. She's just a mother who's lost her child, and a parent who's lost her child. It goes cross-gender. That kind of grief is something we all, as humans, understand. One of the questions I had for Martin was, why doesn't Willoughby and Mildred, why don't they know each other? They're close in age, it's a small town, didn't they go to high school together? And we determined that no, they didn't know each other, so that there was a relationship that could build. But because of Woody's and I, our personal relationship, when we got to the moment where he coughs up the blood and it lands on Mildred's face, there was an automatic reaction to that, and it was an empathetic one. It wasn't an antagonistic one. So I think that that served us. But the, you know, the violence, I mean, I loved throwing the Molotov cocktails. I actually was quite proud that I could land them all the way across the street, because I definitely have a very pussy throw. If you give me a softball, it just looks sad. It goes like that. But for some reason, the weight of that bottle just, it really worked.
Yeah, that's awesome.
And I really loved all the... I don't practice. But I really loved the whole burning of the billboards. I had a little trouble with the running, the long distances, because, you know, I'm
you
not... I did pretty good. Yeah. I did pretty good. But at one point, I was tired, and I just fell to my knees. And then after Martin said cut, he was like, that was brilliant. I love the falling to the knees. I was like, no. That was me. I need a break. I needed some water.
So no stunt women were used for any...
There was somebody that climbed, I forget her name. She climbed up the billboard at one point, but I don't think you had to use it.
No.
At the end of the day. We had a wonderful, wonderful stunt coordinator who's...
Doug Coleman.
Yeah. He choreographed the Revenant, the bear scene in the Revenant, yeah.
He's a fire expert. That's his... He's a pyro, so we were really lucky to have him.
He's awesome, yeah.
I spent my entire childhood growing up in small rural towns around America. So it was, it felt really close. Actually, I'm just going to do a little plug. My mother's from West Lorne. She's no longer with us, but she's from West Lorne, Ontario. And my father's from Nova Scotia. So there you go. What I've found, and this isn't true for all actors, but it's kind of, we were in North Carolina. So even though we were telling a story about Missouri, Silva was Ebbing, because that's where we were. So we didn't really, there's no point in trying to pretend like you're in Ebbing, Missouri. What you do is be in Silva and then call it Ebbing.
Well, yeah, we lost the day player for the dentist, and we got this amazing day player who had a sort of a natural Southern thing, and Caleb's from Texas, Woody's from Texas. So it just was there, you know.
I don't do a lot of research, but one of the things that was revealed to me in talking to people is that the simple fact that, not so simple, but the very complicated fact that when you lose a spouse, you're a widow or a widower. When you lose your parents, you're an orphan. When you lose a child, there's no word. There's no word in the English language for that position, that place that you're left. And we talked a lot about, just technically, for Mildred at least, that there was Angela's death, then 7 months of paralysis, and then she became radicalized. She chose, when she saw, made the decision to rent those billboards, she had her son shave the back of her head, she put on the jumpsuit, and then she was willing to go the distance, knowing that there was going to be collateral damage, most importantly, Robbie, her son, but that the only way that she could survive was by action and not paralysis. So I think that that is the most specific and subjective part of the story, the way that I think that great literature can help a larger cultural conversation is that you take that and apply it to cultural grief and trauma, which I think in America we've been under, not just since September 11th, but since the industrialization of our country. We have not been able to find the right path since then, because we were built on an agricultural society and a nomadic society. It was all about going west. And then there was no more west to conquer. And I think we got really confused. There's a lot of laughs in Greek tragedy. So when you take something this high and you stick your neck out this far, as Martin has done, then you gotta give the totality of the human experience, and just funny and just sad is not the totality. But pathos and humor are Greek.
Yeah, Greek tragedy is a great way to sell the movie, actually.